Today we're going to be diving into this concept of ambient agents, and I'd like to show off how I've been able to integrate this sort of ambient agent mentality around my Obsidian Vault. Now, agents are a huge craze. There's a lot of different ways to think about them, but we're going to talk and dive into what actually makes up an ambient agent and thinking about this kind of trend of agents and thinking about what AI can help us with. How can we make these sort of like agent concepts useful? So first off, ambient agents comes from this presentation by Harrison Chase. Harrison Chase named ambient agents as the kind of term for a lot of what I've been thinking about for a few months. So I really love that this term got coined. Effectively, an ambient agent is any agent that can take some sort of event, and it's event driven. This event gets processed by the agent to produce some form of outcome. That's effectively it. And it's mostly unique in that this event isn't a person asking for something, right? This isn't the same as you doing a deep research query. This isn't the same as kicking off a AI to go and create a photo for you or create a video content for you. This is an event that is triggered by the environment. It could be something that it runs every morning for you. It could be something that happens when you get a certain number of emails into your inbox. It could be any number of things. But the fact that this is sort of event driven allows these agents to sort of respond now in a different modality that doesn't require a human to kick them off. That also comes with some consequence as a result. And we can kind of talk about the pros and cons of this, but it's an interesting way of thinking about how these agents are formed. Now, as we start diving into this, I think it's best to kind of take a step back and just kind of look at the bigger picture, because there's a lot of interesting things happening right now that make ambient agents really interesting. First off, there's a plethora of new AI coding tools that are really driving a lot more UI. And these tools are like Bolt.new, V0, Lovable, Replit. All these tools allow UI to be created faster than ever before. And so as a consequence, you're going to be seeing a lot more dashboards that are kind of aggregating or collecting data. You're going to be seeing entire apps that are built for even like really small tasks. And overall, we're going to see higher quality interfaces because we're kind of standardizing interfaces in some way based on how these tools kind of streamline us toward common, well-understood UI libraries. But that comes with the consequence that there's going to be kind of buggy interface interactions. So let's kind of dive into what I'm seeing. So this is the V0 kind of community portal. And effectively, this is where you can kind of see what people are building with V0. And there's a lot of really interesting and fun ideas at play here. But when we go to the top and we see the things that people are really responding to and what people are resonating with, there's a lot of dashboards. Like 5 out of the top 6 of these are all dashboards. And if we kind of open these up to take another look, like they're very interesting and very, very kind of novel dashboards. There's a lot of animation things going on. There's timers and clocks and usage and all sorts of stuff going on. And it feels very interactive, but you can kind of feel almost right away that this is basically a design mock-up more than it's really a proof of concept. There's not a lot of actual functionality here. This is sort of giving you the sort of illusion of possibility, but it really resonates with a lot of people. Like this has been forked a number of times because people are fascinated by this potential of being able to bring a lot of information down into one place. That's what people are like leaning toward. They've seen these tools that create these dashboards that are really interesting, and they sort of look at that as capability. It's really easy to put capability in your mind when you look at a dashboard, but is that capability really something that exists? One app that just kind of helps me characterize this a little bit better is like Tetris. This is a game of Tetris that you can play. You can push the up arrow to rotate. You can move it side to side. And then you can push down. You'll notice it also scrolls me, which is very interesting. And there's some few features missing that I've kind of noticed as I started playing around with this. There isn't core features that you would expect, like I don't have the upcoming blocks. I don't have a memory of the blocks that that I could like save a block for later. There are some of these like core capabilities that seem missing. And I kind of dabbled around with this and played with this myself. And so I've got my own kind of version of this Tetris where I've tried to implement some of these features. And you know, I'll try and do a space hard drop. And you'll see some interesting stuff start to happen where these blocks are now kind of stuck in space. The next piece feature does seem to work, but some of these core features start to break down. And that's really at the base because these features really weren't built with some sort of overall intent in mind. Similar to these dashboards that are being built, there is an intent for it to look like it does something, but the actual capability of what it can do hasn't really been fully baked yet. And so we're going to continue to see this a lot with these games and these things that are being built with this, where people get excited about what the tool could do for them more than what it actually does in a certain way. And we'll kind of keep expanding on this, but essentially these tools are driving people to build more UI. Whether or not that UI is helpful or not is a question, but these tools are driving more UI creation. When you look at companies that are building dashboards and that are helping people build dashboards, there's a lot of evidence that this is like something that people should be solving. You know, 65% of today's businesses are overwhelmed, says Polymer, effectively. And they're like, okay, we need to be able to aggregate that data and give people a you know, easy way to view it. But really, like, they just need another dashboard. Based on sort of what we're seeing, yeah, people are building dashboards. But is it because they need it? Is it because it makes it simpler? Again, a big question mark. I kind of showed off Tetris. It looks pretty good, but it's missing core features. There's interactions that are missing. And, like, updating the code was hard. Like, I spent some time trying to work through it, but those updates were tricky to make. And so it's a cool design prototype, but it's a really bad dev prototype. At the end of the day, usability is like a difficult task. You're building a lot of UI now, if you're a developer, and then making an interface that people want to use or that people can use is hard. And a lot of interfaces put that blame on the user, but when you become a good designer and when you start thinking about how to build a good interface, you start to blame the interface. Anything a user tries to do with your interface is totally valid. There's no reason that that might be wrong, but what did the interface tell them to expect from that action? If there's something that looks like a button and the user clicks on it, but it doesn't do anything, that's confusing, and that's because of the interface, not because the user is stupid. And so that falls into this whole challenge of really thinking about usability. As we start to see these coding tools drive more and more UI, we're going to see more and more usability challenges because there's not a lot of thought put into how people are using these tools, but yet people are building a lot of UI. And if these tools can help you build UI quickly, and if you can keep in mind how usable these tools are, right? Assuming that, you know, we have now more non-technical folks who may see some of these usability issues more quickly, SaaS is becoming kind of trivial. Being able to build out dashboards that people can see, that people can use to set up servers, manage accounts, update content, right? These traditional paths of being able to build a self-help platform have become a lot easier. It's easy to build a form for somebody to fill out some information that can go into a system and do something for someone. And it's easier than ever to retrace that path that has already been kind of built out. You can see how apps are built today. You can copy it and build that out. So SaaS is becoming trivialized, right? There's a downhill slope toward building a software service platform that can help people self-help. But AI changes this. AI services are actually UI minimal, and they will be. Modern AI services can actually act on a user's behalf. And I think that's a really strong distinction from services that existed before. Rather than you configuring servers consistently, what if there are configurations that are proposed that solve challenges that are understood by the system? Amazon's already kind of doing this in some way with Queue. Say you've got accounts, and those accounts can maybe potentially self-manage and flag decisions for you to make on the accounts that you own. Content updates might be proposed to you. Rather than you having to potentially write content consistently, potentially new ideas could be proposed to you by a research assistant, effectively, an AI that's trying to help you further the goals of your organization. All of these experiences that you have now with these proposals, rather than these just being notifications or flags, potentially these can all become conversational experiences, right? Those notifications that you get could drive into a conversation. And so that's a really compelling view of the future, right? rather than us just thinking about more and more UI being built, which is now easier than ever to do, why don't we respect our users' time? Why are we expecting users to learn more interfaces? Their attention economy is already limited as it is. How do we think about helping users without them having to do anything? And I think that's where AI services start to build a really interesting value offering. I thought about all this stuff. I thought about these ambient agents. I thought about, you know, SaaS and how it's changing. And I thought, maybe this new chat system that I came up with and I presented in the last video, Benny, maybe there's a way that I can make it ambient. Benny is this task-focused assistant. I use it every day to go through my tasks. And so I'll have a conversation with it. It'll pull down some tasks for me. I'll tell it what I'm going through throughout the day. And I'll be able to converse with it in order to be able to kind of structure my day into tasks. With some of the more recent updates, I'm able to give myself a weekly summary of kind of everything I did in the past week. And I've actually implemented into this a new lookup daily note tool, which is able to go and read all the other notes that are in your daily notes in order to be able to bring in past conversations and past ideas. So now we're able to go summarize a week or even a month of all the different conversations that we've had so that all those conversations can be brought in to inform the conversation that we're having. And Benny Chat is great. I'm chatting with my to-do list. I'm leveraging my Obsidian notes as connections for being able to pull in content that I've already built out. And I'm able to search the web as needed, just as conversations end up needing to ask broader questions. But what if Benny could actually make, not only just track my tasks and help me think about my tasks, but what if it could actually help me make progress on my tasks? That's kind of the interesting idea here. Recently, I've been thinking about trying to find wedding shoes for my wedding next month. And I wanted to find a place that was affordable in Toronto to buy those shoes. Now, if Benny knew that I have this task, couldn't it potentially do some preliminary work for me? What could it do? It could potentially look up criteria on the wedding from my notes. If I have anything in my notes about wedding, it could do a quick search and see, hey, have you actually taken any notes about the wedding recently? Is there anything that I can kind of surface about this wedding that might give me some inspiration about what kind of shoes to look for? It can then perform a web search to give me some spots in Toronto. And then it can take all of these searches and bring up the best options for me to review, potentially offering some guidance on what type of shoes I might be looking for. That's a really proactive agent. It's something that's going out for me, even when I'm not asking for it. And I find that a really compelling case. Again, we're thinking about ambient agents. They're taking this event. They're thinking every day about using their capabilities to help me find an outcome. And so for Benny, what that ended up looking like is this agent every night would go and look at my to-dos, my chats, my notes, and search in order to be able to go and find ways to help me with my tasks, to give me a little bit of jump start into the next task that I'm working through. I've actually already implemented this into Benny Chat. And so there's assistant notifications now that come in every day, and it'll give me a quick idea about something that's coming up on my list. I reached out to the director of design and product at Air Canada. I wanted to have a quick meeting with them. And so it gave me a quick background on Air Canada's AI practices. What kind of things that Air Canada has been doing for AI, any relevant kind of AI trends in the airline industry, and potential application ideas that might work. So this just gives me a rough brain dump. And it does some background of research that I actually hadn't really expected it to do, but it just saw there was one event that was coming up, one to do to follow up with a conversation that I had reached out to. And from that, it said, hey, okay, this seems like it's important to you. It's upcoming. Let's do a quick bit of research to maybe help you push along this task. That's exactly the kind of thing I want from an assistant. If I go and I start a new chat, I go to this assistant notification and I start talking with it, it'll bring in that discussion here. And now I'm able to chat with the research that it's done. And so if there's more that I want to ask about, can you tell me more about the Adobe Air Canada connection? And so now it's going to look up Air Canada Adobe Summit 2025 AI. And this is going to be a perplexity search to be able to bring in a bit more information. Great. And so it got me this information at the Adobe Summit. You know, it showcases personalized customer experience journey. Okay, that's really interesting. So Adobe's like working on AI. Air Canada's focused on personalization. So there's an interesting kind of overlap there. I got a bit more information. Sure, let's extract some key points because it's still not clear to me quite what this means. So Air Canada leverages Adobe Journey Optimizer and Adobe Target. Okay, got it. So those are kind of like personalization tools from Adobe. And so I see, so they highlighted some of their applications here. Interesting. So in any case, this helped me really just kind of think through how multifaceted AI might be at Air Canada. I had a particular view of what I kind of thought about AI coming in, and Benny actually helped me to really think through the problem from another perspective. It proactively jumped in to try and help me with this. I think that's a really cool and clever way of kind of going through this. And so this is released and available to any of the users who sign up via the Discord or the Substack. All you have to do, sign up with one of those two services, and I'll send you an invite to be able to access our Discord, which will give you access to Benny Chat. And so when you log in, you'll just sign in with that Discord account. Now, this daily assistant feature is already released and it's already available. And so let me show you what you do have to do to be able to enable it. So after you sign in, all you have to do is go to settings. And inside of settings, there's this agentic daily assistant space. And in here, you just have to enable the daily assistant. And that will start kicking it off basically every night at 1 a.m. EST. And then that will be your ambient agent that's running here. Now, there's a ton I want to improve on it. There's a lot more context I want to give it. I want to start thinking about the way that we think about to-dos, the way that we think about projects in the system, to be able to tie more context into the specific projects that we're working on. And so when I start looking through these different projects, I want Benny to already know what the goal of each of these projects are so that when it sees a to-do related to that project, it knows this project actually has a goal and a purpose and that it can now help me work on this task in context of this project. And I think that's going to be a really powerful way to work through your tasks in a really novel and a really compelling way. I think there are really interesting potential here. I think there's still a long way to go to making these things something that you can rely on very heavily. But I think as helpers, as this layer that relies somewhat on human approval, I think that they're a really compelling tool to use. Thanks so much for watching. If you like this video, if you like thinking about agents and you like to really understanding these concepts from the ground up and what they really mean on the overall industry, we'd love it if you'd go over to stablediscussion.com and go learn more about all the different videos and all the different content that we're making. We've recently been posting a lot about how to catch up with AI, thinking about some of the latest stuff that's been happening, and how to get you up to speed really, really quickly on anything that's more current. We are not a news channel, but we do talk about AI quite a bit. And so we talk about what to think about some of these advancements in a very non-hype based way. We're not trying to push up AI. We're just really trying to analyze it and evaluate how it can help us and how it can work for us. So if you like that, if you like this idea, I'd love it if you go to Stable Discussion and check out what we're doing. As always, love it if you subscribe and like, and we'll catch you in the next one. Thanks so much.